Before we start talking about the paper, which is a really, really cool and exciting study about how ants respond to individuals in their colony when they get sick, I'm going to give a bit more of a background about myself. So I'm a graduate student at Rockefeller in New York City. I'm a fourth year, so I have probably a couple more years to go, but nearing the end, hopefully. Before coming to Rockefeller, I went to Haverford College, which is outside of Philadelphia in Pennsylvania. And I studied biology and neuroscience while I was there. And then I spent 2 years in Philadelphia working at a lab where I studied sleep in a microscopic worm. And really, I'm interested in how brains can regulate behavior. And at Rockefeller, I study this in ants, which is pretty cool because, as you'll see later, ants have some of the coolest behaviors, I think personally. I mean, other people can disagree, for especially how small their brains are. So they have these teeny tiny brains. I'm sure many of you have seen ants before, like their heads aren't that big. There's not a lot of room in there. And it's really, really interesting to better understand how these tiny brains can control so many complex behaviors. And so specifically my research is focused on how the ant brain controls communication. And I just wanted to highlight this by showing a picture of an ant brain, which is massively magnified in this photo. And it's kind of looks like, I don't really know. Like kind of like a piece of toast is sort of the best description I could give for it. And I spent a lot of time looking at these brains and designing experiments and asking questions and wondering about how these tiny brains can coordinate complex social communication between other ants. With other ants in the colony. At Rockefeller, I'm also the co-chair of a group called the Rockefeller Inclusive Science Initiative, where we work towards creating a more inclusive and equitable scientific ecosystem, both here at Rockefeller and beyond. Outside of the lab, I generally enjoy spending time with my family. I have a picture of them here, my mom, my dad, my brother, and our rescue dog. And I'm really lucky that they live close by, so I get to visit a lot. I also have two cats, as I mentioned, currently trapped, so they don't disturb us. And in the center of this slide is a picture of my two cats. My cat Fifi is laying on her back with her paws in the air, and my other cat Ellie is looking down at her, sort of getting ready to play. And I also really like baking, and actually like I'll take that back a little bit. I really like decorating baked goods. And through the pandemic, I've been working on honing my cookie decorating skills and a little bit cake decorating. So I picked three pictures of baked things I'm pretty proud of. Sugar cookies shaped like fruit flies, cookies with trails of ants, and then also a unicorn cake that I made for a friend's birthday. But enough about me, on to the paper. So this paper is called Immune Challenges Increase Network Centrality in a Queenless Ant. And that's a lot of words that aren't often next to each other, but I'll break it down a little bit later. What I really wanna highlight here is who is doing the work and sort of how to access scientific papers like this one. The first thing that I think is really cool about this paper is that it's open access, and that means it's free for the public to download. And this is something that's becoming a lot more common in scientific literature. And I really hope it continues to, so that people beyond those of us who are in like academic science can read these scientific papers. I also want to highlight the authors of this paper. There are a lot of them. They're also from a lot of different places, which you can see. There's some from Switzerland, some from New York, some from Denmark, some from Germany. And I think science is best when it's collaborative. And something really cool about this paper is it actually comes from a multi-lab collaborative project called the Clonal Radar Ant Project, which is a tongue twister and is also known as CRAP, but I'm not gonna use that acronym for, I think, obvious reasons. And so this project is a project that is a collaborative effort between multiple labs, but this specific paper actually comes from Yuko Ulrich's lab, which is located at the Max Planck Institute for Chemical Ecology in Germany. So this is a project that is a collaborative effort. There's also a lot of different scientific backgrounds that the researchers of this paper have. There's a physicist, some biologists, some immunologists, and I think that's also super cool as we start to think about something like ant immunology, where you kind of need experts in ants, experts in behavior, experts in immunology, et cetera, et cetera. So another thing to note about the paper, or really about science in general, is that science is expensive. And so in order to do the research as scientists that we want to do, we have to get funding. And this often comes from government agencies or private foundations or both. The authors in this paper had funding from a variety of sources that I wanted to show here. The first one is the Swiss National Science Foundation. Next is the European Research Council. Next is the Independent Research Fund from Denmark. Next is the Pew Charitable Trusts and the Advanced European Research Council. So now that we've sort of oriented to the paper, broadly speaking, before we get into the background, I want to see what you all know about ants. So I'm curious, do you all know how many species of ants have been described in the academic literature? And I think a poll should pop up. There we go.
All right, I'm gonna end it here.
Awesome. All right, thank you all for participating. I guess, can we share the results, Jeannie?
There you are.
Awesome. All right, so you can see that people guessed, generally speaking, well, people guessed all of the various things, all the numbers. And this is sort of a trick question. I mean, it's not really, because it's asking specifically how many ant species have been described in the academic literature, and the answer to that is about 14,000. But there's actually a lot more ants than that, a lot more species of ants out in the world. And I was sharing the poll on my screen. So science doesn't only happen in the academy or in universities and colleges. And the people who know how many species of ants there aren't always at universities and colleges. And therefore, to get a really true estimate of how many species of ants there are, we really need to work with members of communities who have knowledge about the ants that they see in their spaces and can help us identify the various species of ants. So, more about ants. Ants are what we call social insects, which means that, as Jeannie mentioned earlier, they live in the same nest in a group known as a colony. They're also in the colony, only some of the members actually reproduce. You might be familiar with the queen ant, who, although she doesn't have any political power, actually just lays all of the eggs for a colony, or a lot of the eggs for a colony. And so that's one example of only some members of a colony reproducing. And then finally, there are overlapping generations in the colony. So there are sisters and aunts and sometimes even great aunts that work together cooperatively to take care of the offspring and also make sure that the colony is functioning well. On this slide, I also have a picture of some ants. I have a picture of termites, which are also a social insect, and I have a picture of a social bee. All three of these types of insects meet these criteria to be called a social insect. You might also be asking yourself, besides that ants are kind of a nuisance, why do we really care about studying ants? Why are scientists spending all this money to study ants? And I mean, maybe I'm sort of biased, but I think there's a lot of reasons for that. Today I'm going to focus on ant behavior, but there are also reasons outside of just behavior why ants are interesting to study. First off, as I alluded to earlier, ants communicate with each other to maintain their social structures using chemicals that they then smell. And this is really cool considering how small their brains are, and because they really need to be able to communicate in order to keep group living sort of a happy and good situation. Ants also need to be able to make decisions as a group in order for their colonies to be functional, which again is interesting. It probably requires some communication. It also probably depends on how many ants there are in a group. As you can imagine, more ants probably means a bit more chaos in the decision-making. Ants also divide up tasks that are necessary for survival, and sometimes some of the ants in a group, in a colony, are experts in different tasks, like the queen I mentioned earlier, who sort of takes charge of reproduction, or some ants that are nurses that take care of the offspring and forage. Some ants are foragers that go and look after food. And this is particularly interesting because ants in a colony are generally super similar genetically because their mother is the queen. So they're usually at least somewhat related, but they have all these various tasks that they perform. Ants can also accomplish really complex tasks and create and modify their habitats. And to highlight this on the left, I have a picture, one of the coolest ant pictures I've ever seen. It's a picture in a forest that has sort of a brown crown structure. And this is taken entirely from ants, it is made entirely of ants. It's a structure known as a bivouac, which is an ant nest that's made entirely from the bodies of ants. And I think that's just really cool. We also study ants to learn about how they deal with difficulties, because they are a social insect, and they have situations that sometimes look like ones that we deal with as humans. And so today we're going to be talking about what happens when there's a disease in the colony and what ants will do at an individual and at a group level. So at an individual level, ants, and actually all insects, don't make antibodies. So you might have heard a joke about ants not getting sick because they have tiny antibodies. Ants actually don't make antibodies to fight disease, but they still do have immune systems, and they do have immune responses to things that cause disease. Their immune systems act non-specifically, kind of similar to the beginning of, at the beginning of infection for humans. The immune system just works to kind of get rid of anything that might cause disease and just turns on whole body responses before having a more specific response like an antibody. In addition to individual immune responses though, ants have social behaviors that also protect them from disease. Kind of similar to how recently we have been hopefully social distancing and wearing masks to prevent getting COVID and spreading it throughout our own communities. So these strategies that ants do to protect their colonies, and specifically to protect everybody in their colonies, not just themselves, are called social immunity. And social immunity can really just be defined as any action that is performed by an individual in a group that works to prevent disease in other individuals in the group. So not protecting yourself necessarily, but protecting others. And so in ants, what this looks like, there's a couple different strategies that ants use. The first strategy that ants use is grooming, which kind of makes sense. If an ant has some sort of disease-causing microbe or something on it, if you were an ant, you would want to get it off of you. Similar, we want to wash our hands when we go outside. So here's a video showing an ant grooming itself. This ant is cleaning her antennae using her front legs. In this video here, and in the background, there are actually some other ants grooming themselves. And some of those ants are grooming themselves, and some of the ants are actually grooming other ants in the colony. And so grooming, whether it be one ant grooming itself or one ant grooming another, is a really important strategy for social immunity that ants use. Next up, and another way that ants prevent against disease is by keeping their nests super clean. So they often have specific waste piles to prevent trash from piling up. Some ant species also spray antimicrobial disinfectants that they make with their own bodies into the nest to clean it, which I think is pretty cool. It's like if you like made Lysol and could in your body and could spray it. I think that's pretty neat. And finally, ants will isolate or remove sick individuals or dead individuals that might spread disease to others. This isolation or removal can be self-inflicted, so an ant can see that they're sick and leave, or it can be something that's initiated by other members of the community. And I think it's important to mention that some of these things seem contradictory, right? I talk about grooming and how ants will groom each other to protect against disease, but also they'll remove sick. So this sort of starts to bring up a question that this paper will be asking that we'll get to in a second. But before that, I want to, we have one more poll question, and this is the joke edition. And why don't ants get sick?
All right, sharing results.
Awesome. You guys got it. So this is a really bad joke. Feel free to tell it. I didn't make it up. I found it on the internet. But I wanted to highlight that ants don't have antibodies, and they also sometimes prevent getting sick using social things rather than their individual immune systems. So they do sometimes spray disinfectants in their nest to protect against disease. But this joke, I mean, besides being a really bad joke, also isn't exactly right, because despite having both these individual immune responses and social immune behavior to prevent against disease, sometimes ants do get sick. And real quick, before we jump into that, I just want to share and introduce my favorite species of ant and the species of ant we're gonna talk about in this paper. You already heard about the clonal raider ant project, so you might have seen this coming, but I want to introduce the clonal raider ant, which is the species of ant that this paper uses. And something that I think is cool about this ant is that it's actually named after two of the really cool features of its behavior. And the common name was actually decided on by the lab that I currently work in, Dr. Daniel Kronauer's lab, before I arrived, when they were sort of deciding to start studying this ant. So I think that's super neat. So what does clonal raider ant really mean, though? The first thing about this ant is that it reproduces clonally, which means that it creates genetically identical offspring and actually doesn't require both a male and a female to make offspring. The females just clone themselves to produce these genetically identical offspring, which is really nice in the lab because you don't have to like get the mood right for the ants to mate or have to deal with the male at all. Something else really cool that is not in the name, but I guess is sort of related to them being clonal, is that all of the females in this species of ant reproduce, which is just a really cool feature. And so these ants actually don't have queens because everybody can lay eggs. These ants also raid, they're raiders. So the way that they find their food is that they raid the nests of other ant species and take their eggs and their larvae, basically their babies, and eat that. So in the lab, we actually feed them the offspring or the eggs and the larvae of fire ants that we have to go to Georgia once a year to go collect because there aren't fire ants in New York City. So now that you know a little bit more about the clonal raider ant, let's hop into the paper. As I said previously, the paper is called Immune Challenges Increase Network Centrality in a Queenless Ant. So to break that down, we know the queenless ant is our friend, the clonal raider ant. We just talked about that. These authors are going to study immune challenges. So essentially, they're going to test the immune system of these ants. And they're going to look at network centrality or the social network of the ants. So the main question is really something like, what happens to the social network of an ant colony when an ant gets sick in this clonal raider ant species? And the way they address this question, they could have addressed it in a bunch of different ways, because we can create scientific knowledge through different approaches. These authors took the approach of experimental evaluation, which means that they perform controlled experiments to answer the question of how the network of an ant colony is impacted by sickness. And then they broke this big question down into smaller questions so that they could design better experiments to test one or two variables at a time. So the first smaller question that the authors asked was, do sick ants interact with the colony similar to healthy ants? And I mean, just thinking about it, I could imagine this going at least two ways. You could imagine a sick ant might isolate themselves, a strategy we talked about earlier, or a sick ant might not isolate themselves because they need to be taken care of by other ants in the colony. So they'll do some experiments to test this question. The second question the authors asked is if sick ants are groomed more than healthy ants. Again, another strategy of social immunity that we discussed earlier. And you can see how these questions could be linked, but maybe not. So if sick ants maybe isolate, then they're probably groomed less, or maybe they don't isolate and they're groomed more, or maybe something will happen that will surprise us because that's sort of what happens in science a lot, and we're humans and we don't think like ants. So yeah, we have to do the experiment, and that's exactly what they did. So the first thing that the authors needed to do was to make ants sick. And they wanted to make sure that any behaviors that they saw were because of the ants being sick, generally speaking, not because of the specifics of how they're sick. So to compare this to humans, if you are watching one person with the stomach bug, and it wouldn't be right to conclude that everybody who's sick throws up, because when you have a cold, you don't always throw up. Maybe you'll sneeze or do something else. So the authors wanted to make sure they were finding something that looked, was just really an activation of the immune system rather than something specific about the ant being sick. And so the way they decided to activate the ant's immune system was really similar to how we all hopefully have been immunized against COVID-19. What they did is they found a bacterial protein from a bacteria that generally causes disease, and they injected that into the ant, which caused an immune response similar to how you didn't feel so great after getting the vaccine. You don't usually feel good after getting a vaccine for a little bit because your immune system is ramping up. They also wanted to make sure that any behavioral effects that they were seeing were because the immune system was activated. And so they also had ants that they injected saline or salty water into just to make sure that any effects they were seeing were really from the immune response, not from the injection themselves. So we'll get really familiar with these ants, but I'm showing here the sick ants in blue and the control injected ants in orange. Next, the authors decided to put these ants into colonies where there was one sick ant, one control ant, and seven normal ants that they hadn't touched, hadn't injected, hadn't done anything to. So each colony that they set up had these nine ants in it. And they recorded the behavior of these colonies for 2 days. And then they analyzed these behavioral videos to see what was going on. What were the ants doing? Who were they interacting with? How much grooming happened? And just a quick note throughout the rest of the presentation, blue will correspond to sick, orange to control, and green to untouched, untreated normal ants. But those reminders will be there throughout the talk. So let's get back to that first question. Do sick ants interact in the colony similar to healthy ants? The way that the authors went about looking at this is that they tracked the behavior of ants in videos, and they tracked where all the ants went using a computer program that kind of works similarly to what would happen if you took a marker, a really tiny one, I guess, and attached it to the butt of the ant so that it drew a line everywhere the ant went. So here I'm just showing you a video of what ant behavior, what these clonal raider ants look like when they're just walking around normally. And so it would draw a trail as this ant walks along here, or as this ant walks along here. This video isn't from this study, it's just another video of the ants. So, let's see. All right, cool. So when they look at these tracks, the first thing they notice is that sick ants don't walk around as much as control or untouched ants. And so to orient you here, this circle is representative of the dish that the colony is kept in. In the right over here is the nest where the ants have some of their larvae and eggs. I think eggs, actually, not larvae, sorry. And what the authors asked is, where did the ants go? And so this blue line here is a track from one of the sick ants. And what you can see is that the ant definitely didn't walk around as much as the orange control ant or the green untreated ant. It definitely went to the nest and it definitely walked around a little bit, but it didn't move around nearly the same amount. On the other hand, the control ant and the untreated ant seemed to have wandered all around. They were in the nest, they were sort of wandering around over here, walked all the way around. So far what we know is that ants don't walk around that as much as when they're sick as when they're healthy, but they do spend some time inside of the nest and outside of the nest. So the next thing that the authors wanted to do is ask if who the ants, sick ants came in contact with. It seems like they're not isolated. They're walking around. There's other ants nearby. So to do this, they built a contact network. And to walk you through this, this is the contact network of every individual that I've been in contact with today. Kind of feels like contact tracing. So these circles represent individuals. So you have me, you have my roommate, my cat, my friend, my neighbor, and the lines connecting these circles indicate who had contact with who. So I had contact with my cat, my friend, my neighbor, and my roommate. My neighbor also had contact with my roommate, but my neighbor and my friend didn't have any contact. And the final thing to note about these graphs is that the width of the line indicates how long these connections were for. So you can see that I spent a lot of time convincing my cat to cuddle with me this morning by the thickness of the line. My roommate must have done the same thing because her line is pretty thick too. But I just saw my neighbor in passing, so there's just a pretty thin line. So, and the last thing I want to say about these is that the actual location of all the circles doesn't really matter. You can see that even though I'm in the middle of this figure here, I actually might have the same amount of contact time overall as my cat who's on the side, who contacted less individuals, but seems to have been held probably hostage against her will with both me and my roommate for longer. So the authors did exactly this, except instead of asking the ants who they were in contact with, they could take, well, one, ants can't talk, but also they could take this information from the tracks that we talked about earlier. So in blue, you can see that this is the sick ant here, and the sick ant was in contact with a lot of other ants in the colony, a lot of the other healthy ants. You'll notice that similarly, the control ant in orange and the other untreated ants in green also had a lot of contacts with other ants in the colony. It also looks like the sick ant had some fairly prolonged contacts, like this one here that is pretty thick. So that's a pretty long interaction. And so what this tells us is that sick ants in the clonal, sick clonal raider ants don't seem to socially isolate from others. Something else interesting to note about this ant is that, or this graph and this sick ant, is that it seems like it still was in contact with a lot of other ants. So it doesn't seem like there's maybe just one or two sort of like healthcare worker ants whose job it is to take care of the sick ants. A lot of the ants in the colony interacted with the sick ant, and it seems to be more distributed. So that kind of leads us to the next question the authors ask. The ants don't seem to socially isolate when they're sick. What are they doing with all this physical contact? Maybe do the sick ants get groomed more than the healthy ants? Which, as you remember, is also another sort of form of social immunity. Maybe it's really important for the ants to be groomed when they're sick. So to do this, the authors went back to the videos and they looked for grooming. And this is actually a video from another ant species, but just to demonstrate and remind you what grooming looks like, this is one ant grooming another ant. You can see that she has her front legs and also her antennae sort of all over the ant grooming it. And so this is sort of what the researchers looked for, and they took account at the total number of seconds that the sick and the injected control ants were groomed for. And so when they did this, they then graphed the data. And so to orient you to this graph before I show all of the data, because there's a lot, on the y-axis, we have the number of seconds that grooming occurred for. So a higher number means more groomer, a smaller number means less. And on the x-axis, we have how long after the ant was sick did this happen for. So they actually looked at this 6 hours after making the ant sick, 12 hours, 18 hours, every 6 hours for over 2 days. And what they found, when I show the data in a second, is that one, they collected a lot of data. And to orient you a little bit, these The blue circles are individual ants, and it represents how long they've been groomed for. And the orange triangles are the same thing, but for the control ants. And what you can see is that the blue dots are, generally speaking, higher than the orange dots, especially at the beginning of the experiment at 6 and 12 on the x-axis, and the end of the experiment at 54. And so this is sort of expected. What this indicates is that sick ants are groomed for more time than healthy ants, the healthy control ants. And this is expected because we know grooming is a way that ants prevent disease. And we also know that these ants who are sick were in contact with other ants. So it makes sense if this helps prevent disease, this is something they might be doing. But it's also sort of confusing if the ants are grooming, if the healthy ants are grooming sick ants, is that making them sick? Is this sort of helping the sick ants get better? We don't really know why the sick ants are actually being groomed more. And so the authors asked one of these many questions that sort of come up: why do ants groom sick ants more? Is it sort of a, does it serve any kind of survival purpose? And specifically, the question that they asked, or the experiment they did, was what happens when you isolate sick ants? Does it make them die more because they need to be groomed and they need to be interacting with other ants? Or do they survive the same as if they were in a group? And so to do this, you might remember these sick ants that I've been talking about this whole time actually weren't, they were sick, but they didn't have any sort of pathogen or any sort of disease making them sick. It was an injection. But in order to sort of easily figure out what happens and figure out survival, you need a pathogen that's going to make the ants die. And so to do this, the authors took a fungus that's known to kill the ants. It's known to be a deadly pathogen. And they soaked ants in a solution that had the fungus, the sick ants, and these were the sick ants. And then they soaked control ants in a solution without any fungus. And so this allowed them to say that, well, basically it will allow them to see if soaking the ants alone causes them to die, which would be bad, or if they need to be soaked with the fungus in order for there to be sort of a sickness, which is what you would expect. So next they created their experimental groups. They grouped the ants this time in groups of either 5 or 1. So they had groups of 4 regular old ants, 4 untouched, straight out of the colony ants, and 1 sick ant or 1 control ant. And then they also isolated just the sick ant or the control ant alone. And what they did is they then checked daily for the survival of the ants. And so to orient you a bit to what this kind of survival curve looks like, this is a survival curve for orange and blue. I mean, you might guess where this is going, but pretend that these have nothing to do with sick or control. And this orange line, you can see, never touches the x-axis. It stays sort of horizontal to it, which means that at the end of the experiment, most of the ants are alive, or most of whatever this is showing is alive. On the other hand, the blue, it's sort of like a staircase down, and by the end of the graph, you can see that the percent alive is 0, indicating that everything is dead. So the authors did the experiment, checked every day to see how long ants were survived, and they plotted the data really similarly to what I just showed you. So again, to remind you, on the x-axis, we have the days after treatment, after making the ants sick, and then on the y-axis, we have the proportion of ants surviving. The first thing I want to point out when I show the data, which is right now, is that all of the, both orange lines are at the top. And so the orange, they're actually overlapping. You can't tell which is which. But the two orange lines indicate the control ants. And this is really good. The line being horizontal, never touching the x-axis, indicates that these ants aren't dying, which we want to make sure. And they did this experiment and this control because they wanted to make sure that, 1, soaking the ants alone didn't kill them, and 2, isolating them alone didn't kill them if they didn't have any pathogen. But when you give a pathogen, when you make the ants sick, this is where we really see a difference. So in the blue dotted line, you can see this looks really similar to these control ants. The blue dotted line indicates ants that were in a group. So ants that are in a group seem to survive the infection pretty well. But on the other hand, the other line, which is the solid line, these are the isolated ants. And you can see that this looks more like the staircase we saw earlier. And by day 9, all of the sick ants that have been isolated are dead. And so this is really cool. It seems like sick ants survive longer when they're with other ants. And in fact, when sick ants are isolated, they die much, much sooner. It doesn't necessarily mean that this increased survival is due to grooming, but it makes us think more, oh, maybe grooming or something about being with other ants makes sick ants survive for longer. And that's really where the paper leaves us. There's some more things that I don't have time to talk about today, but to summarize, the authors ask the question, what happens to the social network of an ant colony when an ant is sick? And it's a pretty big question. They broke it down into a couple pieces. First, they asked, do sick ants interact in the colony similarly to healthy ants? And the answer is, yeah, they do. They don't seem to isolate, but they do seem to have lower activity. So from a social perspective, they interact really similarly. But from just a general activity perspective, they do have lower activity levels. Next, the authors asked if sick ants get groomed more than healthy ants. And again, the answer is yeah, it does look like sick ants get groomed more. And it might be true that this grooming helps ants survive, although we don't necessarily know that it's the grooming or just being with other ants that helps sick ants survive for longer. And so the authors discuss this really interesting phenomena where the clonal raider ants adopt a caring strategy to take care of the sick. And this is really interesting because you can sort of imagine some of the benefits and some of the costs of this kind of strategy. On one hand, for benefits, obviously we saw there is some increased survival for the sick individual when they're around other ants that can care for them. There's also some evidence, not in this species of ant, but in other ant species, some really cool papers that talk about how grooming a pathogen or something that causes disease off of the surface of an ant could actually help build resistance to that disease in healthy ants. So maybe the clonal raider ant is doing something like this, and it's actually grooming is not only beneficial to the sick individual, but to all of the individuals in the colony. On the other hand, there's some risks. First off, if you're taking care of an individual who's sick, there's an increased risk of the disease spreading, an increased risk of you yourself getting sick. It's also, and this I don't like saying, but it's true, for an ant colony that has limited resources, it's sort of a waste of resources if they're taking care of sick ants and then they die. And so that really leaves us with a lot of unanswered questions, which I think is the coolest part about science, is you learn so much in a paper, but you also come away with so many other things that you want to ask in the future. And I've thought of some questions that I've kind of thought were interesting from this study, but I'd also love to hear during the Q&A any more that you might have thought of. So first off, how do ants detect a sick ant in their colonies? Do sick ants smell different? I don't know. Next, what happens if multiple ants in a colony are sick? Does this caretaking strategy still happen at some point? If there's too many sick ants, is it no longer possible? Does the caretaking strategy that ants do depend on how sick ants are? Maybe with this fungus that the authors used, because it's something that's survivable, the ants would take care of and groom the sick ants. But maybe with something that was more deadly or more dangerous to the healthy ants, maybe they would isolate the sick individual. And then finally, as I sort of alluded to, does grooming really act, or could it act as some form of immunization for healthy ants? And with that, I'd really love to thank the authors for writing such a great paper and doing such cool research. Rocky, to you for hosting another exciting session of Data for the People. Jeannie, for allowing me to talk, and all of you for your attention. And I'm happy to take any questions.